Great. Well, if you can keep your Bibles open there, that would be brilliant, because we're going to take a little look at that passage in a moment or two. Just going to ask ourselves a question. A question. A question that John wanted his first readers to take a look at. Here we go. Do you believe? Do you believe? You see, behind every outrageous claim that you've heard this week, and every outrageous act that Jesus has displayed, and the combination of the claim and the act showing us the outrageous love of Jesus, is this major question from John. Do you believe? You see, it was John's purpose when he wrote all these things down, that those who would read, those who would hear and know what Jesus done would come to believe. But these are written, it says, that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. You see, John longs that the claims and the actions and love of Jesus are made real in your heart, in your life, in mine. You see, Jesus wasn't just about a display of action. He wanted to change the heart. He wanted to transform not just water into wine. He wanted to show us about another transformation that was taking place and could take place in the heart. He didn't just raise Lazarus from the dead for effect. He wanted to tell us something about death and life and the power that he has over death and life. And we could go through a resume of what we've done this week and pick up on these things. Do you believe? Well, our final outrageous claim this afternoon is found in the words that we just read a moment or two ago from John chapter 15. Verses 1 and verse 5 says this: I am the true vine. You are the branches. The "you" in this statement is a direct reference to the disciples, because here was the setting. Let me just remind you of the setting. It was the night when Jesus was betrayed. It was the night before he went to the cross. He was together with his disciples having a meal in a table in an upper room, and Jesus was having this long conversation with them, speaking to them of many things. Part of this is what we're reading here right now. And the "you" in this statement is initially a direct reference to his disciples. But it goes wider than that. It's broader than that. Because this "you" also means everyone who believes. Everyone who trusts and believes in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that will include you. If you trust in Jesus as your Savior and your Lord, the "you" in these verses refer to you as they would refer to me. So let's take a look at Jesus' claim to be the true vine. What is he talking about? What is he going on about here? Well, in the Old Testament, Israel represented the vine. There's a picture that was given of what Israel was. And the purpose of the vine is just one thing. It was to produce fruit. That is all the vine tree did, was produce fruit. It's an interesting type of tree. It wouldn't be a tree that you'd have in your garden for decoration. It wouldn't be the kind of tree that you'd have maybe as a hedge to form a barrier for something. What happened with the vine tree was it was planted to produce fruit. If it didn't produce fruit, it was chopped down and thrown away. If it did produce fruit, once fruit was produced, it was all cut back straight away so it could reproduce more fruit. You wouldn't look at the vine tree and go, oh, that's a pretty tree. I'd love that in the back of my garden. The purpose of the tree was to produce fruit. But Israel failed. Israel failed and was cut down and burned. We find reference to that in Psalms and in Isaiah. Israel as a nation failed on two accounts. They should have been an obedient people. They should have been a people who loved God and served God, because God had rescued them and brought them out of slavery into their own land and set them up as his own people. And their response to God ought to be in obedience, love, and service, following the God who rescued them, ever thankful for all that God had done. Yet they failed. We are told that they should have been a light to the nations, that you should be a light that tells all the other nations about this God who saves, this God who is great, this God who is above all gods. And yet we find that they failed completely. They failed to produce fruit. They failed to live obedient lives. In fact, not only did they not follow God, they chased after other gods. Not only did they think God was not worth serving and loving, they went, I fancy the God of that nation, and I fancy the God of that nation, and I'll have a bit of that, thank you very much. And we find that they failed completely in being a light to other nations and failed in an obedience to love and follow and serve God. Their ultimate act of failure? Well, their ultimate act of failure was this, was when they rejected God's own Son when he came and he crucified him upon a cross. The result? That Israel was cut down and burned. And it's into this setting that Jesus comes, speaks to his disciples, and he reveals to himself and says, I am the true vine. A huge contrast to what Israel were and had been in their history. Jesus says, I am the true vine. And he demonstrated how he was the true vine. How? Because he lovingly obeyed his Father. Everything he said was the words that the Father had given him to speak. Everything he did in response to the Father. He always wanted to do the Father's will. And we find that Jesus lived a life of complete obedience. And not only that, at his birth, we are told he would be a light for all nations. And Jesus, we know as we read stories about him, embraced people from all nations, from other cultures and backgrounds. We heard last night, didn't we? Anyone can come to Jesus. Anyone. And Jesus lovingly obeyed his heavenly Father and declared that he was a light to the world, as we heard earlier in the week. Jesus is what Israel, the nation, failed to be and do. Now here's the extra part, if you like, to Jesus's outrageous claim. I am the true vine. And then Jesus says, you are the branches. Remember who the you are in this? All who believe, all who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are the branches. And the purpose of you being a branch is to go out and produce fruit. You are a branch connected to Jesus, and your purpose is to go out and produce fruit. How is it you are connected to the vine? How is it you are connected to Jesus? You are connected in this way, by the Holy Spirit. Remember again, Jesus is speaking on the night before his crucifixion. He's telling his disciples that he has to go, and when he goes, he will send the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will come. When I go, the Holy Spirit will come to you. Now, very quickly, here's the work of the Holy Spirit. Hopefully, you looked at some of this morning. This is the work the Holy Spirit does. John 16, verse 8, John 15, verse 26. When he comes, he will convict the world. When he comes, the Spirit of truth will testify about Jesus. And he will help you testify too about the Lord Jesus Christ. That simply means, the whole set of verses there simply mean this. It's the work of the Holy Spirit that brings people to faith. You're not a believer because of anything that you have done. You are a believer because God, through his Holy Spirit, has drawn you to himself. And it's the Holy Spirit's work to bring people to faith. It's the work of the Holy Spirit to go before us and to testify about Jesus and to speak of him. And it's the work of the Holy Spirit who will help you to speak and me to speak and you to live and me to live for Jesus. Living lives that are pleasing to him. Living lives that produce fruit, much fruit, fruit that will last, John says. And this will be the evidence to show that you belong to Jesus, that you really do trust and believe in him. Who is the Holy Spirit? How are we connected to the vine? By the Holy Spirit. Who is the Holy Spirit? Well, the Holy Spirit helps us to enter this race of life. It's the Holy Spirit who will keep you in this race of life. And it's the Holy Spirit who will bring you to the end of the finishing line and bring you home. It's the work of the Holy Spirit that does that in you. Let me try and help illustrate this if I can. You see, Jesus is with his disciples, isn't he? And imagine this such situation. Jesus says, I have to go, I have to leave you so the Holy Spirit can come and live in you. Imagine if Jesus says, I'll tell you what, guys, I'll stay with you. I won't go, I'll stay with you. Because that's what the disciples wanted. We don't want you to go. And just as they finish the meal, Philip says to Jesus, Jesus, do you fancy coming with me? I'm just off to Capernaum. But Peter goes, oh, Jesus, I wanted you to come with me. I'm going over the Lake of Galilee on the boat. Will you come with me? And Andrew goes, oh, I was just going to go to my mate's house down the road just to go and have a natter. I'd love you to come with me. And he can't be in all places, can he? He can't go with Peter, and he can't go with Andrew, and he can't go with Philip. And so Jesus says, listen, it's for your good that I go, because if I go, then I can send the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit can be with you wherever you go, because it's me living inside you. And so when you go home and you go to Birmingham, and you're a follower and believer in Jesus, guess what? He's in Birmingham with you, because he's in your heart. And he follows us across the M4 and over to the other side of the country, to London or to Cambridge or further up north to Bradford or to Liverpool or across the pond to America. And Jesus lives in us and he goes, I can be with you always by my Spirit. It's Jesus who lives in us. And that is why Jesus is able to say, when he left his disciples, some of his last words he said before he ascended into heaven, he says, I am with you always. How can that be? Because he lives in us through the Holy Spirit. And as he lives in us, he helps us to live for him, producing much fruit. Get into the finishing line in his strength, with his help, along the way. But do you believe all this? Is it just purely a head exercise that we're on about this week? An exercise of engaging the brain? Or is it a matter of the heart? Do you believe this? The outrageous claims, the outrageous actions, the outrageous love of Jesus displayed for us as John writes it down. Well, I've got a final question alongside the do you believe this? Does it really matter? Does it? Does it really matter? Is our final question. Well, I want to say this. And it's with this we're going to finish. Yes, it does really matter. John 15, verse 6, it gives us a severe warning. Let's read it together. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. You see, friends, do you really believe? Is a question for you. And you know something? It really, really does matter. It really, really does matter. It matters what we do with the things we've heard this week. The claims, the actions, and the love of Jesus. Because if we do not remain in him, then Jesus leaves us in no doubt what the consequences will be. We are like a branch that is picked up, thrown away, discarded, rubbish, wasted. The branch will wither and it'll be thrown into the flames and it will be burned up. It does matter. John wrote this letter so that you may believe, and that by believing you may have life in his name, the fullest of life, the choicest of life, the death-defeating life, the eye-opening life, the fruitful eternal life that he longs to give us through trust and belief in him. It does matter. Do you believe? We're going to pause and we're going to watch a DVD just to remind ourselves again of what we've heard this week. And the question, do you believe, is your question. Does it really matter? It matters to you. Thank you.